I'm reading from Isaiah chapter 40, verses 1 to 31. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her hard service has been completed, that her sin has been paid for, that she has received from the God's hand double for all her sins. A voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up, every mountain and hill made low. The rough ground shall become level, the rugged plains places a plain. And the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all people will see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice says, cry out. And I said, what shall I cry? All peoples are like grass, and all their faithfulness is like the flowers of the field. The grass withers, and the flowers fall, because the breath of the Lord blows on them. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers, and the flowers fall, but the word of our God endures forever. You who bring good news to Zion, go up on a high mountain. You who bring good news to Jerusalem, lift up your voice with a shout. Lift it up. Do not be afraid. Say to the towns of Judah, here is your God. See, the sovereign Lord comes with power, and he rules with a mighty arm. See, his reward is with him, and his recompense accompanies him. He tends his flock like a shepherd. He gathers the lambs in his arms and carries them close to his heart. He gently leads those that have young. Who has measured the waters in the hollow of his hand, or with the breath of his hand marked off the heavens? Who has held the dust of the earth in a basket, or weighed the mountains on the scales and the hills in a balance? Who can fathom the spirit of the Lord or instruct the Lord as his counselor? Whom did the Lord consult to enlighten him? And who taught him the right way? Who was it that taught him knowledge or showed him the path of understanding? Surely the nations are like a drop in a bucket. They're regarded as dust on the scales. He weighs the island as though they were fine dust. Lebanon is not sufficient for altar fires, nor its animals enough for burnt offerings. Before him, all the nations are as nothing. They are regarded by him as worthless and less than nothing. With whom then will you compare God? To what image will you liken him? As for an idol, a metal worker casts it, and a goldsmith overlays it with gold and fashions silver chains for it. A person too poor to present such an offering selects wood that will not rot. They look for a skilled worker to set up an idol that will not topple. Do you not know? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood since the earth was founded? He sits enthroned above the circle of the earth, and its people are like grasshoppers. He stretches out the heavens like a canopy, and spreads them out like a tent to live in. He brings princes to naught and reduces the rulers of this world to nothing. No sooner are they planted, no sooner are they sown, no sooner do they take root in the ground than he blows on them and they wither and a whirlwind sweeps them away like chaff. To whom will you compare me? Or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes and look to the heavens, who created all these. Who would bring out the starry host one by one and calls forth each of them by name because of his great power and mighty strength? Not one of them is missing. Why do you complain, Jacob? Why do you say, Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, my cause is disregarded by my God? Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They'll run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, thank you very much, Clendon. I'm sorry that was such a long reading, but read beautifully. But I think it was important that we had the whole chapter, because this is quite a pivotal chapter in the book of Isaiah, and we're going to be looking at some passages from Isaiah from now leading up to Easter. But this chapter is a change in tone, and we're going to look at that today. The whole chapter, I'm afraid. So who was Isaiah? He's widely regarded as one of the greatest prophets in the Bible. His name means Yahweh, or the Lord, is salvation. He lived in Jerusalem in the 8th century BC, and the prophecies that God gave him were directed towards Israel, Judah, and many other nations. In the first half of the book, Isaiah reproved Israel and let God's people know in no uncertain terms that rebellion, pride, idolatry, sin would not, cannot go unpunished. Our God is a just God, as well as a loving God, and he can't leave sin unpunished. I mean, that's one of the reasons that we do confession every week, to keep our hearts clear before the Lord. Chapter 39, the chapter just before this, had predicted Israel's exile to Babylon. In our reading today, chapter 40, Isaiah prophesies about a time when the exiles to Babylon, they were taken as slaves and prisoners, when they would return to their home country and Jerusalem. And the passage began with a persistent double imperative: comfort, comfort my people. This isn't just positive thinking, is it? This isn't a happy app, but it's heartfelt consolation. What's striking is not that there were persons in need of comfort. Someone once said, "Speak to broken hearts and you'll never lack an audience." No, the striking thing here is that Jerusalem is the one that God says is to receive comfort. In the context of the book of Isaiah, Jerusalem is hardly a sympathetic character. Read it through sometime, it's quite scary. Chapter after chapter describes how the people of Jerusalem prospered through wickedness, oppression, lies, and injustice. They refused to listen to the prophet's calls to repent, to reform, and to be reconciled to God. And then in 587 BC, Jerusalem was conquered. These prophecies came true, and it was destroyed by the Babylonian Empire. The leaders and a significant part of the population were marched off to Babylon. The Jerusalem prophets made it unmistakably clear that the destruction of the city and the exile to Babylon were not due to Babylonian strength. They were a well-deserved punishment from the Lord. But now God says to comfort them. What's the message of comfort? At the moment that Isaiah spoke this, Jerusalem was well aware of her sin. Isaiah had made them aware of it. Yet he also speaks of a day when the punishment would finish, when comfort could be offered because the sin of the city was paid for with the punishment. This is real comfort. To be recognized as a sinner, and yet knowing that our debt of sin has been paid and we are forgiven. This is a real reason for comfort. Isaiah then goes on to prophesy of a voice in the wilderness, calling out to prepare the way of the Lord. The idea is that the Lord is coming to his people as a triumphant king. The road has to be prepared before him so that he can travel in glory. Whatever was wrong in the road must be corrected. The problems were not the same everywhere. Sometimes the road in the valley needed to be lifted up. Sometimes the mountains had to be smashed down. This is a word picture because the real preparation for the coming of the Lord takes place in our hearts. But building a road is very much like the preparation that God has to do in our hearts, including smashing down some of our views and values that we may hold dear. And the purpose of all of this? To show the glory of the Lord. And God's glory is revealed without regard to nationality. We read in this chapter, all people shall see it together. It wasn't just reserved for the Jews or the Israelites. All of us can see the glory of the Lord. This passage, verses 3 to 5, had a direct fulfillment in the New Testament in the person and ministry of John the Baptist. Jesus was the coming Messiah and King, and John the Baptist's ministry was to be one crying in the wilderness, in the desert, and through his message of repentance to the people, he was preparing the way of the Lord, preparing for Jesus to come, telling people to repent, prepare their hearts for the Lord to come. But what shall I cry, he asks. The voice in the wilderness knew he had an important work, but wanted to know more exactly what the message would be. All flesh is grass. The message is of the frailty of mankind. Isaiah was thinking of the beautiful green grass covering the hills of Judah after the winter rains. The spring flowers in all their beauty. But how quickly the grass dies. The hills are left brown and barren. Didn't we see this last summer? Everywhere was brown. How quickly things die. And that's the picture we're given of the frailty of mankind. Later on in the chapter, we come to hear that people are as dust. You can put these pictures together. It's a very vivid picture story, this chapter. But in contrast, we're told the word of our God endures. It survived centuries of manual transcription, of persecution, ever-changing philosophies, all kinds of critics, of neglect, both in the pulpit and in the pew, of doubt and disbelief, and still the word of our God endures. Unbroken chain, the word of the Lord stands firm, centuries later, millennia later. And Isaiah's declaring it right here. We're frail, we fade away, we blow to dust, but the word of God never does. But then, this is a little bit weird for me, the people were commanded to announce the good tidings to the cities of Judah. Jerusalem, this really sinful city, which had been judged, conquered, exiled in condemnation, and then it's to be involved in voicing comfort to others. That's difficult, isn't it? Coming back from exile and now having to comfort others. So Isaiah reminds them who their God is. And he makes this wonderful statement. Here is your God. I want us now just to pause, to take a few minutes to meditate on who God is. The wonder of God, the power of God, the majesty of God. We're going to meditate while we listen to a piece of music that Hilary, Lizzie, and Joe recorded during lockdown. An ancient hymn of the glory of God. Give some meditation time now. Lizzie, and also Joe. How important to take time to think of our God. His glory, his power, his majesty. Here is your God, says Isaiah. He then goes on to say he's the God over all creation. God is so great and so dominant over all creation that he measured the waters of the earth in the hollow of his hand. He's measured the heaven with a handspan. Calculated the dust of the earth in a measure. And he weighed the mountains in scales and also the hills. He's the God of all wisdom. Nobody has directed the Spirit of the Lord or taught him. And then Isaiah measures God's greatness in comparison to others. He looks at nations, and the glory of a powerful nation is quite something to behold, and maybe to fear. We think of a huge military parade with all the strength of the nation on display. But compared to God, it is nothing. The greatest glory of the greatest nation, Isaiah says, is like a drop in a bucket compared to the greatness and glory of our Lord. You can think of the greatest nations of history, the greatest empires, all gone to dust, haven't they? God remains, and his word endures forever. And then verses 21 to 31 go through a couple of repeats, okay? So verses 18 to 20, Isaiah says, with whom will you compare God? To idols made by humans? Really? Verse 21, do you not know? Have you not heard? He's the creator of it all, and he can reduce princes and rulers to nothing. Verse 25, to whom will you compare me, God says. And once more, creation imagery serves as a way to address this. Look to the heavens with their starry host, the moon, all the stars. Are any of them missing? Have any of them floated away? No, God has named them. With the billions and billions of stars in the universe, it's staggering to know that God can number and name them all. I feel really chuffed with myself if I can name three or four. Verse 28, again, do you not know, have you not heard? I think Isaiah is saying here, how thick are you? The same power used to make the heavens and the earth will be leveraged on our behalf, renewing and strengthening the people then and us now. Humans get tired, even young people, but God doesn't. What a comfort this must have been to the returning exiles to hear this. Imagining a future, physical travel towards Jerusalem, rebuilding a city still largely destroyed, those who returned to Jerusalem would find their share of struggle and disappointment. But after reminding them of the incredible power, majesty, and wonder of the Lord, showing the people to whom he had said, here is your God, he finishes the chapter by telling them and us that all of this is available through the Lord's loving care to us. He gives strength to those who are weary and power to the weak. This incredible power and wonder is available to us to give us strength and power when we need it. He says, but those who hope in the Lord shall renew their strength. And how do we receive this strength from the Lord? By getting to know him, by meditating on him. Not a passive sitting around until the Lord does something, but he brings this strength to us as we seek him and rely on him instead of our own strength. And then these beautiful, beautiful lines, which we've just sung. We will soar with wings like eagles. How incredible. And this is a measure of the strength the Lord gives us. Strength to soar above everything else, above the everyday. We will run and not grow weary. We will walk and not be faint. This is the purpose of the strength the Lord gives us. Strength to move forward and to do the work he's given us. It isn't strength to show off, but strength to go forward. So put your hope in the Lord. Meditate on him. And our amazing, wonderful God can reactivate us, renew us, and refresh us. Let's pray. Father Lord, thank you that you offer us, all of you, your power, your majesty, your strength. Lord, your love we already know, your forgiveness we depend on. But Lord, we ask you to help us to get to know you in all of your wonder, power, and majesty. In Jesus' name, amen.
The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice, 'cause he wraps himself in light, and darkness tries and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great, how great is our God.
There is so much to say to the Lord, to organize our thoughts. After each section of prayer, when I say, "Let's pray to the Lord," please respond by saying, "Lord, have mercy." Let's pray. To whom will we compare you? Who is your equal? Our Heavenly Father, as we gather here to worship you today, we are reminded again that you are the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. We admit that we are weak and grow weary from time to time, but you do not, and no one can fathom your understanding. We pray that you would renew our strength, and we would stumble less and fly under your wings. Isaiah calls people to make straight in the desert a highway for you. We are fully aware that there is so much in the world that needs straightening out. There's terrorism, war, natural disasters, and horrendous accidents. Our hearts go out to the land and people of Ukraine as they confront Russian aggression and invasion. Open the eyes of those who have been overtaken by a spirit of deception and violence, that they would be horrified by what they have done. We pray that you would grant victory over the powers of evil and bless Ukraine with liberty, peace, and prosperity. We also remember the grieving families and friends of the earthquake victims in Turkey and Syria. Please keep the survivors warm in the midst of this harsh winter and provide all they need. Lord God, we thank you for the swift action of those who have responded, and we ask for endurance, resilience, and compassion. Lord, we pray for world leaders as they decide how to respond, and pray that you make our hearts generous to the people of Turkey and Syria. For the peace of the whole world and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Heavenly Father, you have called us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ, to continue his work of reconciliation and reveal you to the world. Forgive us the sins which tear us apart. Give us the courage to overcome our fears and to seek that unity which is your gift and your will. For our brothers and sisters all over the world, for our bishops and for the church in this diocese, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Lord, you bring princes to naught and reduce the rulers of this world to nothing. No sooner are they planted, no sooner are they sown. No sooner do they take root in the ground than you blow on them and they wither, and the whirlwind sweeps them away like chaff. For you are the king of all the earth. You reign over the nations. The kings of the earth belong to you. Lord, God of righteousness and truth, grant to all the leaders in the world the guidance of your spirit. May they never lead their nations wrongly through love of power, desire to please, or unworthy ideals. But laying aside all private interests and prejudices, keep their mind their responsibility to improve the condition of all mankind. So may your kingdom come and your name be hallowed. For Charles, our king, for the leaders of the nations, and for all in authority, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. We think of everyone who is facing financial difficulties during this cost of living crisis. May all in poverty access the support they need. We thank you for all the initiatives people in this church are involved in to alleviate poverty and to bring the endless love of Jesus to those in need. We pray for healing for Joe and Jiffa, for a successful operation for Andrew, and for comfort for those who mourn over the loss of their loved ones. Now we pause and pray for others dear to us who are in need of your help. For this village and local community, for the cities, towns, and villages from which we come, and for all the peoples of our nation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God. Lord, help each one of us to be ready to share the hope we have in you and enable us to live out our faith. Show us how our lives can be straightened out so that your healing, restoring power may flow through us to the world around. We commit ourselves, one another, and our whole life to you once again. For ourselves, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Let's now pray the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.